Welcome to FIU's Global Learning New York Times discussion with Thomas Kaplan, Facts and Fake News in Politics and Journalism. I'm Hilary Landorf, Director of the Office of Global Learning Initiatives. For those of you who are familiar with our university-wide Global Learning Initiatives, thanks for coming and supporting what we do. For those of you who aren't familiar with Global Learning, let me tell you a little bit about us. We help everyone in the FIU community increase their ability to understand the interconnections among problems in different parts of the world, analyze issues from multiple perspectives, and take action to make the world a better place. We do this by offering over 180 courses throughout the undergraduate curriculum in which our diverse students, you, collaborate to analyze and solve local and global problems. And we also offer events like this one in sponsorship with the New York Times, the Student Government Association, and the libraries. To find out more about global learning and how you can become involved in globally themed clubs, earn a global learning medallion, join our Peace Corps Prep program, or participate in other globally focused events, look us up on the web at goglobal.fiu.edu. Find us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, or come to see us in our new offices on the second floor of the PC building. And to this afternoon's event, I'm pleased to introduce you to our speaker, Thomas Kaplan, a congressional correspondent for the New York Times. Tom started at the Times in 2010 as a sports intern, moved briefly to Deal Book and then to upstate New York, where he wrote about New York politics and corruption scandals, including the sexting of Anthony Weiner. As a 2016 campaign reporter, he covered John Kasich, Hillary Clinton, Tim Kaine, Mike Pence, and Donald Trump. Since the presidential inauguration in January, Tom has been full on covering the health care bill from its inception to its defeat last Friday. In his coverage of this bill, as well as in stories like that in December, alleging that Hillary Clinton had a child sex trafficking ring in the back of a pizza parlor, Kaplan has been forced to think about and write a lot about facts and fake news, and all too often the dire consequences of not being able to tell the difference between the two. Tom Kaplan's reporting is on the forefront of one of the most important questions of our time. Are we headed toward a post-fact world? So please give him a warm welcome.
So thank you for that generous introduction, and thanks for having me here. I'm happy to be here. I'm going to save a lot of time for questions and to chat a little bit about this subject, just given that certainly there's no shortage of things to talk about here. But for now, I'm going to begin with a little bit of a presentation and some slides. It's good to be back in Florida. I was here often last year covering the campaign all over the place, in this area, in St. Pete, in Tallahassee, in Orlando, you name it. And it's very nice to be not rushing to catch a plane to fly to another state, which typically it would be like a few hours here and then rush to an airport and fly somewhere else. And it's nice to actually be here for a day or two. I spent a lot of last year on the campaign trail. I think I wound up in somewhere around 37 states over the course of the year covering a number of candidates, John Kasich during the primaries, and then both major party nominees and their running mates. Traveling with them, which in most cases that would mean like flying on a big plane. Hillary Clinton sits in the front of the plane, you sit in the back of the plane, and you fly around to all these places. I also wrote stories about policy during the campaign, so I wrote about everything from Bernie Sanders and his views on gun rights, to what evangelical Christians think of Donald Trump, to Tim Kaine's conflict over the death penalty when he was the governor of Virginia. And during the primaries, I worked a lot on fact-checking, which is what I'm going to focus on today. Since the election, I've covered Congress. I've been writing, as was mentioned, about all the sort of twists and turns in trying to repeal the Affordable Care Act, which came to a crashing halt at the end of last week, although who knows if there'll be more twists and turns to come. So when we chat, I'm happy to take questions about healthcare, about Congress, about the campaign, you name it. But what I'm going to start with is what I'm going to kind of argue is a real essential part of political journalism today, and that is fact-checking. Just to take a step back, we cover campaigns to shed light on the people who are aspiring to be our leaders, to help the public understand who they are, how they make decisions, what they plan to do in office, how they view the world. It's why people talk about journalism as a public service, the idea being that in writing these stories, in shedding light about the people running for office, you can help voters make informed decisions at the ballot box. And that's kind of a given. I think when people think about political coverage, that's what you kind of think about, what you see on TV, what you read in the paper. We cover rallies. I know, you know, there were candidates who came here during the campaign. We interview the candidates about what they would like to do when they're in office. We write about where they stand on the issues. We talk to voters to see what's on their minds, what they think about the direction of the country and what candidates have to say. But fact-checking is another element and a pretty critical element of campaign coverage. It's another element of helping to keep the public informed and giving people sort of the context they need to make informed decisions. And that's especially true in this age of social media where people can get information not just from picking up the paper in the morning, which I hope you do, not just from watching cable news, the evening news, you name it, but also from Facebook and Twitter and lots of different places where someone can post something, it goes viral, and that can reach many, many, many eyeballs, just in the same way that when I write an article, in theory, it does. So fact-checking is really a way to kind of cut through that noise and help people have context for what they're hearing in a campaign, and for us as journalists to hold the candidates accountable. So setting that out as a goal, I want to talk about a little bit how we go about this. So I'm going to go through how the New York Times in the 2016 campaign sought to fact-check the candidates and hold them accountable for what they have to say. So this is a challenge on a number of fronts. One, obviously, which I'll talk more about, is the journalism. Candidate says something, figuring out, is that true? Is that false? What did they leave out? What should people know? But there are other things to keep in mind. One is speed. Typically, writing stories, you might have some time to formulate your thoughts and talk to people and do the reporting, you know, that goes into something like that. But a big part of fact-checking is speed. It's candidate says something, it doesn't do much good to write something a week later saying, hey, by the way, that thing in the debate last week, that wasn't quite right. So speed is very important. Another thing we tried to focus on was presentation. So a lot of kind of what I'm talking about, the idea of fact-checking what candidates say, not necessarily the most exciting thing, the most interesting thing to read about, not the most kind of dramatic, captivating subject to say, well, what he said about our corporate tax rate was not quite right. So we try to come up with a way to fact-check the candidates in a way that was engaging, so that people with looking at our coverage on their phones, for instance, would be able to, with a pretty quick glance, without sitting down to read like a political science dissertation, could get a grip on the facts. So this is basically the template we followed in the primaries, which was a time when there were many candidates, there were many claims flying left and right, and we came up with this format to fact-check the candidates. So just to give one as an example, sometimes when we talk about fact-checking, we're talking about facts and figures and numbers, where it's pretty cut and dry. So this example, with Mr. Candidate Trump talking about the size of our trade deficit with China. Well, that's something you can look up. So we did. And when we tried to do these fact checks, we would keep them pretty short, as you see on the presentation here. Another one like that, what's the murder rate in Chicago? This is a Christie example. And again, it's something you can look up. It's a numbers. This is what we know how to do as reporters to figure things out like this. And we would write things like that. Other times, it would involve talking to experts. This is an example. Mr. Trump talked about signing an executive order so anyone who killed a police officer would get the death penalty. We rated this one with red. That's not really how it works. The president can't impose sentences on people. That's not the way that works. And so in this case, you could talk to experts. So I think in here, there's an expert on capital punishment, a professor who is quoted in this particular item. So it depends what the subject is, how you kind of go about trying to figure out whether something is true or not. And in other cases, I would rely on colleagues of mine. So there are many reporters of the New York Times who specialize in different areas. So writing a fact check about ISIS, I might talk to a colleague of mine who their job is to cover terrorism, and they're really an expert in that subject. To talk a little bit about the format we used, we tried, as I said, to keep it succinct to make it accessible to people. This is actually probably not a great example because it's a bit on the long side. We would assess things as red, yellow, or green, depending on kind of the level of accuracy. Ratings can be tricky. Different people who do fact-checking do it in different ways. So you may have heard of PolitiFact, which is really a pioneer in this. They're a project of the Tampa Bay Times here in Florida. They have what they call the truthometer, and they rate things true, mostly true, half true, mostly false, false, or pants on fire. Catchy. The Washington Post has a feature called the Fact Checker. They use what they call the Pinocchio test, rating things 1, 2, 3, or 4 Pinocchios. So things like that. There are pluses and minuses on these rating scales. It's obviously judging something's accuracy is not really a scientific thing. So it's kind of hard to figure out the categorization. We would sometimes argue over, well, is it red? Is it yellow? Is it somewhere in the middle? So that's a kind of a tricky thing sometimes. One time where we found that fact-checking really was something readers really were interested in and demanded and were engaged with was during debates. So what we would do, we'd have a team of people during the debates. This is from the general election, but we did this during the many, many primary debates as well. We'd have a team of reporters who were ready. And basically, to give you a sense of how this goes, the debate starts, we're all sitting there. It's me and others who have sort of policy expertise, so like a healthcare reporter or an environmental reporter. And you're basically sitting there ready, and as soon as somebody hears something that sounds fishy or that they know is wrong, someone would say, I'm gonna do that one, and would try to do a fact check very, very quickly. The goal would be to try to get these done in a matter of minutes, you know, maybe 10 minutes, so that as people are watching the debate, we would do these kind of live chats during the debate so that you could watch the debate on TV, have your computer or your phone open to our sort of running commentary, and we would do these fact checks that would show up as the debate was going on. The whole idea being you're watching this and we could hopefully give you some answers, not the next morning, not the next day, not a few days later, but as the debate is going on or very quickly thereafter. There were other times, too, when we would do fact checks. Colleagues of mine would be traveling with a candidate, would hear something the candidate says, and they would alert us back in New York saying, hey, you should look into this. I would look at transcripts of candidate interviews on, like, you know, Meet the Press or on TV, and things might pop out at you. The idea being, if you're sitting at home watching something on TV and it makes you wonder, could that really be true? That would probably be a pretty good fact check, whether it's true, false, or somewhere in between. So those were some of the different ways that we would launch on these things. Another big one was readers talking to us. So we put a call out to readers saying, write us. If you hear something fishy, alert us, send us a note, and we'll try to look into whatever it is that you've heard. And this was particularly popular during debates, where you would just get a flood of notes from readers who You could even kind of predict it. You would hear a candidate say something that seemed far-fetched, and then immediately it would just be a flood of emails saying, hey, can you look into that? Another thing we would do to try to spread the word on this stuff was through social media. So we had a little gadget we created in-house that would turn the fact checks into little images that could be tweeted. So that was another way to, maybe for people who weren't, you know, specifically looking for this kind of thing, they would see it on social media, on Facebook, on Twitter, and this proved another popular way, and a pretty accessible way. The idea being, you know, it's the color helps, the graphic helps in a way to get this across to people in a pretty easy way. Another thing we did, this was another sort of form of experimentation.
In just 3 days, voters here will decide who they think should be the Republican nominee for president.
Right now, we're the highest taxed country in the world.
CNN reported that Ben was not going from Iowa to New Hampshire or South Carolina. Rather, he was, quote, taking a break from campaigning.
What Donald Trump did was use eminent domain to try to take the property of an elderly woman on the strip in Atlantic City.
Under Chris Christie's governorship of New Jersey, they've been downgraded 9 times in their credit rating.
So this was another, this was pretty cool, especially because I have no idea how these things actually happened. We would do the fact checks during the debate. We would publish them, as I was talking about before, and then very talented colleagues of mine who work in video would magically produce this. It would just appear within a matter of hours. And it's a great way just to try to get this type of thing across in a different format. People looking on their phones, it's a way that, you know, you might not want to sit there and read a dense or even read a couple paragraph fact check, but it's engaging. You see the video of the candidates. It was a way to experiment. And a lot of what we were doing in the campaign when it came to fact checking had to do with experimenting with different ways to tell stories. So we have these tools now. You know, if you were talking back in a printed newspaper age, you couldn't do all these different kinds of formats to try to hold candidates accountable like this. You could really just write a story. You could really just do sort of blocks of text. You couldn't do the kinds of things that we can do now with the web, and especially engaging readers saying, write to us, which wound up being a particularly successful thing in getting people to reach out. Another thing we tried to do and worked on was how to surface fact-checking in our coverage. So it's one thing during debates or people who Google, you know, is something true, or campaign fact-checking, but to a reader who just clicks on the story of the day about the presidential campaign, how do we expose some of this journalism to them? So one thing we tried a little bit was inserting fact-checks into the actual stories we were writing that were on a relevant subject. So this, an example of Ted Cruz's birthplace, a story on that subject and a fact check we had done on that was inserted in the text of the story. Just another way that readers consuming our coverage could stumble across this kind of thing and then maybe click and read some more fact checks. This was a case that was tricky from a production standpoint to be able to do. So we weren't always successful in doing this, but it was something we tried, and it was all about kind of experimenting over the course of the campaign with this kind of coverage. Another thing to talk about in this area, so I've talked so far about our fact-checking team and our sort of specific effort to fact-check the candidates, but think of all the stories you've read over the course of last year about the campaign. It's also important, I would argue, that there's a fact-checking component in everyday coverage. So for instance, two candidates are out there, one says one thing, one says the other. If like the news of the day is a candidate saying something that's factually flawed, that's not accurate, it seems to me a little bit not ideal to do a story that kind of overlooks that part and just leaves the fact-checking for like the fact-checkers. So one thing we would also try to do is in our actual stories point out if like the basis of the story was a statement that was just like a clear falsehood, to try to address that in the story so readers would know and not have to look elsewhere to find that out. So one I think particularly notable example of this was a story in September about Donald Trump and his birther claims over the years. This was notable. This is the lead story of the paper in September, and used the word lie in the headline, as you can see. And that's a pretty unusual thing for reporters to do. It's a word that reporters tend to be pretty careful about using because it ascribes motives. It suggests not just that something's inaccurate, but it's suggesting intent, that that was an intentional false statement. And this was a case that was so clear cut. It was a falsehood crafted out of thin air that had been told over a long period of time that the decision was made to use the word lie. And this was a pretty powerful story. It certainly got some attention in the journalism world for going there. And I think it's an important thing talking about fact-checking and what we worked on, but also stories like this that really call something what it is so that readers can see that without specifically going to like a fact-checking page. We kept doing this kind of thing in the general election in different ways, using different formats. This was a fact-check of Hillary Clinton's acceptance speech at the Democratic Convention. We used a little bit of more of an article format and also had a video that went with it. I did this with a colleague of mine who covers the White House. We did something similar just recently for President Trump's joint address to Congress, where we similarly had a team of reporters at the ready to evaluate claims he made. You'll notice the format's a little bit different. We didn't use the colors that we used last year. We also did a similar feature here for the Democratic response to the president's address by a former governor of Kentucky. This is another way we got at sort of this accountability fact-checking task just recently in the debate over the repeal of Obamacare. This is actually just a sort of a story, an explanatory story. One thing that Republicans said a lot over the debate about repealing the health law was that Obamacare is collapsing, it's in a death spiral. And this is a story by two of my colleagues who write about healthcare and insurance, getting at the fact that experts it doesn't really hold up, that there are certainly problems with the health law, but that it's not quite in the dire state that some Republicans describe it as being. So they wrote sort of more of an explanatory story that fulfills a similar aim to what I've been talking about. This is another piece. We've been doing some of these regularly, looking at things that are in the news and claims that are made and assessing their accuracy, particularly in this administration where it's certainly, I'm not going out on a limb by saying that President Trump does not have a strong record in terms of accuracy in various claims he's made over the course of the campaign and continuing in his young presidency thus far. So just to step back a second, I want to talk a little bit about, and I'll take questions in a moment, and we can talk about some of these issues, some of the challenges that we face in doing this kind of work, in doing fact-checking and assessing the accuracy of what candidates are talking about. So we talked about debates. I talked about debates a little bit. One question is, what should moderators do? If a moderator is running a debate and a candidate says something that's just baseless, is it the moderator's job to chime in and say, no, that's not true, in real time, in sort of a live fashion? The idea being, of course, that as much as I hope everyone watching the presidential debates would then read our coverage and read our fact checks, that's not the way it works. Many more people would actually see it in real time than would, you know, follow up to read coverage by us and by others. So that's a question that's been debated. Moderating a presidential debate is certainly a hard enough task without having to then weigh in, and there's some debate over the appropriateness of doing so. Is that putting a finger on the scale? So that's one question I think that's worth talking about. Another is fake news. And this is a growing phenomenon over the course of the campaign that is something that was beyond what we were contending with. We were fact-checking statements made by the candidates. We would fact-check campaign commercials. That's something that's been done over the years, and that's a kind of a known quantity as well. But we weren't fact-checking other people's stories or other things that appear on the internet. And that wound up being quite a conundrum, especially as the campaign went on. This idea of stories appearing online, sort of invented out of thin air for a variety of purposes by websites that pose as news organizations, and that sort of adds to the confusion that people may have over truth and a lack of truth. A recent study by two economists found that of false news stories in the couple months before the election, in the 3 months before the election, fake news stories favoring Mr. Trump were shared something like 30 million times on Facebook. And similar fake stories favoring Hillary Clinton were shared around 8 million times. That's a ton of people seeing those stories, and certainly in many cases probably not realizing what they are seeing. Facebook is actually taking steps to try to tackle this issue, which is kind of an interesting new development in this area, attaching warnings to stories that are shared that are you know, quote unquote fake news stories or have been disputed by independent fact checkers. So this shows a Facebook post and a little warning that now appears noting that something is amiss. And if you click on that, you get a little bit of an explanation, and you get links to read articles by independent fact checkers that will shed light on whatever it is that is there. And just to test this, I tried to post one of these stories that had been flagged, and you get a warning. Facebook tells you it's been disputed by fact checkers and suggests that, like, maybe that might not be the best thing to be sharing with your friends. So it's an interesting step by Facebook to try to tamp down some of this stuff and at least provide ample warning. I mean, people are free to post what they wish, but at least they're hopefully realizing that something may be awry and that it's not a news story from a credible news organization that they're sharing. Another thing in this area that is problematic and complicates matters is trust in the media. This is something that probably is no surprise to you, but you know, public opinion research has shown that the public does not hold the media in particularly high esteem for a variety of reasons. A Gallup poll in September found that only 32% of American adults said they had either a great deal of trust or a fair amount of trust in the mass media. So 32%, that's down from 50% in 2005. So that, again, adds to this sort of challenge. It's a broader subject than this discussion, but we talk about fact-checking. I would get emails from people who would say, why should I believe you? And that's a tough thing to answer. There are certain things that I would try to do to help along those lines. I would try to kind of show my work. So instead of just saying something is false, you try to provide either links to data or links to articles or kind of showing how you get to that conclusion. So in theory, someone reading it, you know, doesn't have to just take your word for it. They can sort of follow the logic and see for themselves. But it's a challenge. And it's a challenge that I think, again, I'm not going out on a limb and saying has become greater given some of the rhetoric we've seen from the president. He has called the media, the enemy of the American people. Earlier today, he tweeted the failing NY Times would do much better if they would, I can't read my own handwriting here, but it was attacking the honesty of the Times. And that kind of thing certainly doesn't help in terms of how the public perceives media coverage and perceives what they're getting from big news organizations. So that's another thing that just makes this kind of work more difficult when what you're trying to get across to people is assessing accuracy or lack thereof, and people are from their leaders, or in this case, the president, being given reason to be skeptical. Whether that's valid or not is a broader discussion. And it's a particularly, I think this subject remains relevant because of what we've seen thus far from his presidency. He is, I think, attracted a lot of people during the campaign with his sort of off-the-cuff, some would say like stream of consciousness style sometimes, which is different. It's a reason why in talking to voters around the country, people would say, he talks like us, he doesn't talk like a politician, which was appealing to an awful lot of people. But one consequence of that is oftentimes would say things that maybe were not strictly tethered to fact in the way we tend to expect often, particularly from the president. So it's a challenge for journalists in covering the administration and covering Washington now to continue to do this kind of work, which always should be a part of our coverage and certainly was under President Obama as well. But there's no shortage of material now that has kept fact checkers busy to date. So with all that being said, I'm eager to take your questions and talk more about this issue, both fact-checking, the campaign, healthcare, Congress, you name it. Sure.
I'd just like to say we're here with the school newspaper. I have editors here just for an informative session. Our question pertaining to President Trump's accusations of fake news. With the new administration in Washington, fake news has been a reoccurring topic across the nation. President Trump has singled out the New York Times and CNN and classified them as fake news. Do you feel that President Trump is justified in his accusations, considering the extreme bias by the American media against his administration? Do you feel that, and I guess another follow-up question would be, do you feel that the American media as a whole is hyper-partisan against President Trump? Do you feel that news sources are covering President Trump's administration with the least amount of bias to the best of their ability?
Sure, let me answer that in a couple of different ways. I think, so first of all, on the topic of fake news, one thing that I find worrisome, and I think should be worrisome to people, especially talking about the topic of perceptions of the press and trustworthiness, is I've noticed in Washington in the past few months, people have started to use the term fake news, not to describe actual fake news, but to describe like stories they disagree with and stories they don't like. And that's not particularly productive, I don't think. And I would argue that the president's usage of that term probably falls in that category. I think as for generally coverage of him and his administration, I would say a couple things. I mean, it's the role of the New York Times and CNN and other news organizations like that to hold public officials accountable and to report on what they're doing, their actions. That's I mean, a pretty fundamental part of the job. And I think that's what we've done, that's what other places have done, and it's what we would be doing regardless of who the president is. One thing I would always find during the campaign, when people would complain about, you know, the New York Times is out to get Donald Trump, you would also get people who would say the New York Times is out to get Hillary Clinton, or the New York Times is out to get like anybody. You can always find supporters of a candidate who will complain about tough scrutiny in the media of that candidate, but that's the media's job. As for coverage of the administration so far, I think we and others have covered it in a tough way, which is trying to inform the American people about what their government is doing. And I just don't buy, you know, the suggestion that there's some agenda or motivation. And I mean, I could point you to President Trump himself, who came to the New York Times in November and described the Times as, quote, a great, great American jewel. So, like, just it's a natural reaction for politicians to criticize tough coverage. It predates President Trump, and it will continue after him.
I want to say, I pick up a copy of the Times every single day for my students, and we do follow the Times specifically for our news coverage. One thing that I always stress to my students is to try to look at news articles with the least amount of bias or partisan use possible. And like you said, Donald Trump has kind of gone back and forth with the New York Times. One thing that I want to quickly ask is, as the next generation of journalists, what steps can my students and students across the country take in order to decrease the level of bias in our coverage?
So, a couple things I would say. One is, and I think this is related, and it's an important sort of point to talk about, it's very easy in this day and age to kind of tailor your media diet, your consumption of news, to reflect kind of how you look at the world and to sort of confirm or reconfirm your own views of things. So you can tailor your Facebook feed to be news from a perspective on the left, if that's how you look at things, or you can consume news from perspectives on the right, if that's how you look at things. And there's a certain danger of kind of being in a bubble there, and both sides are guilty of it. So I would encourage not just people going into journalism, but consuming news, to try to consume a wider spectrum of news. Don't just watch Fox News, don't just watch MSNBC. See what the other side is having to say, because that at least gives you a fuller sense of sort of what the arguments are on both sides. So I think that's important. And I also think from a bias point of view on that subject, I mean, it depends what kind of journalism we're talking about. I mean, we have columnists who write opinion columns in our newspaper who certainly have a perspective, and there's no question about that. The editorials that appear in our paper certainly have or generally perceived to come from a certain perspective. Having said that, that's separate from our news coverage. I have nothing to do with that. They have nothing to do with us in terms of the actual coverage. And separating kind of commentary from covering the news, I think, is a fundamental thing that not everybody, I think, realizes, that, like, we're not all, I don't have any say on our editorial stances, or should I, and vice versa. Yeah? Whatever you prefer.
So my question was, I wanted to ask you, so how come Congress, like, scrutinizes or criticizes CNN and NBC, even out the New York Times and everyone, and there's, like, what is it, do you think, like, in your opinion, it's the kind of rough, what's really happening with them anyway? Or why are they specifically attacking these news sources instead of, like, you know, Kellyanne Conway, who's, like, the current counselor for the president? Everyone knows that she was still alive all day through the media. So I'm just trying to figure out, like, why he's trying to hide what's really happening and has this lady, has this, you know, current counselor to Congress.
I mean, I think to some extent, It's not a new reaction for an administration or for politicians. Criticizing the media, criticizing coverage that is critical of you is like that. That's pretty much, it's understandable. It's, to me, it's not. But I mean, certainly the media criticism aligns with President Trump's kind of anti-establishment, drain the swamp sort of message. Basically portraying, you know, the mass media as this sort of out of touch institution that, you know, it fits into that. I think it fits into that message a little bit, but the idea of criticizing, you know, coverage that you don't like, that's has happened before, will happen again. And if you're in my line of work, like, you know, that's gonna happen, and that's, you know, you're ready for that. Yeah.
So in your experience for the New York Times, especially during the primaries, we saw multiple candidates, like you said, flat out lie or sometimes give information that's inaccurate. So do you think that it is an intent on their part to lie to the public, or is it a failure to kind of be thorough in their own fact checking? Like the group of people that work with them, you know, and say, these are the facts that you're going to use in your speech.
Right.
So is it intentional, or do you think it's just a matter of not being thorough enough?
I think it depends. I think there are certainly situations where, you know, it's not surprising or new that politicians will stretch the truth in making an argument. And sometimes it's a matter of how far do you go, and do you go a step too far. In other cases, you know, when I talked about Mr. Trump's speaking style during the campaign. So one thing for much of the campaign that was unusual, when he would have rallies, he would not use a teleprompter. It was very, I even tried at one point kind of mapping out like what a Trump rally speech is like. And he would hit a lot of different topics. And you know, you got the sense that every word out of his mouth had not been vetted in the way that, for instance, the Clinton campaign had a big communication staff, a big, you know, she tended not to sort of have things pop in her head and she would blurt them out in a way that, now that's also, I think, a fair critique of that campaign, which was people described it as too scripted and too kind of reading from what like focus groups said, you know? So it's a little bit of both. And like the reason why I used the birther example where we used the word lie was that was like a particularly egregious example where like, I don't think there's an argument that can be made that like, he was just mistaken and thought that was, you know. But the last thing I would say is, having spent a lot of time traveling with candidates and seeing them on the campaign trail, you're talking all day long, you're giving interviews all day long, you're giving speeches all day long. You can see how somebody would slip up. Yeah. So you know, that's life. That happens, and it's a lot of pressure in that setting. Yeah.
I have a question specifically about one news source, and then I suppose a personal question for you.
Yeah.
So how would you describe Breitbart's credibility? And then your personal preference in news organization that isn't the New York Times?
Yeah, sure. Good question. So I was asked about Breitbart yesterday, too. I don't really want to offer media criticism. This is a little bit of a dodge of your question, just because that's not what I cover, and I'm also, in full disclosure, I have not been a long-time Breitbart reader. I used to write about politics in New York. That's not really, wasn't a relevant news source in kind of what I covered up until a little over a year ago. So I don't have a great grip on what, on their coverage. Obviously, during the campaign, when Steve Bannon was advising the Trump campaign and playing a big role, and there were Breitbart reporters covering the campaign, that raises obvious journalistic questions over their coverage. And I will say one thing that kind of falls in my area now, people read Breitbart stories in DC with a certain amount of intrigue, trying to figure out like, are they writing the story because Trump is going to come after this person, or because Bannon is going to come after this person? They posted recently leaked audio of Paul Ryan being critical of President Trump back during the campaign, and like the timing of that was interesting, and people tried to dissect about like, was that intentional? We had a story over the weekend about Paul Ryan and being damaged by the healthcare debacle, and mentioned that there were some critical Breitbart stories about him, and that leads to questions. This long-winded dodge of your question is not meant to condone anything they've written about anybody over the years or anything like that. It's just a little bit out of my my area, but it's certainly a topic of conversation in the Washington journalism world. Yeah.
I don't know your experience with international politics. But do you think this fake news in politics is a very American phenomenon? Does coming from Europe and covering the elections there compared to here, this first time in America, I can see some like Washington base like some really wide generalizing statements. Is that common here?
I don't have a good sense of what it's like abroad. I suspect that the use of propaganda in campaigns does exist in significant ways elsewhere. It's just not something I'm too familiar with. But that also, an important question in this whole thing and in this discussion of fake news is like, what role did foreign actors play in this whole thing? I think it's definitely an element of the discussion about like foreign interference into the election. And it's not an area I know a ton about, but I just don't have a great grip on. I forgot the other part of the last question about my news sources, right? So it varies a lot. So during the campaign, I would try to read not only like the major national outlets, but also like local and state coverage of candidates to see how somebody comes and campaigns here. Like what's the Miami Herald story look like, to get a sense of that. Certainly now, I mean, I think this is something I'm guilty of and many reporters are guilty of. I have a little bit of like tunnel vision in that like I read a real lot of stories about Congress and not as much about other things. So I read the Washington Post, the Wall Street Journal, Politico, the AP Wire, things like that. But those are sort of the things that you have to read just because they're your competition and you need to know what's going on. Yeah.
Do you think that Trump's campaign in Congress is it just initially just like I would say criticizing CNN and the New York Times because they're like an American entity as a journalism when it comes to news outlet, compared to like, criticizing NBC because they're international?
I don't sense a distinction there. I mean, I think it's more, and I don't have a great read on which outlets he's criticized the most and kind of how that breaks down. I think it more corresponds to...
It comes down to the fake news.
Well, I think it comes down to the coverage. I think generally, both for Mr. Trump and during the campaign and for other politicians, it's generally in response to... you can draw a direct line between the criticism and like tough stories. I think it probably has more to do with that. That's just my general sense. You can get into like a little bit of psychoanalysis. Like I think it's probably fair to say that President Trump cares about like the Times, the Post, and the Daily News in a way that a politician from somewhere else in the country might not, just because like he's a New Yorker that's been sort of his media world for quite some time. So there's been some speculation about that, but that's sort of more what I would say. Other questions? Yeah.
What kind of feedback have you gotten since the New York Times started including those embedded fact check pieces in the middle of the article? Is it still that you get, for example, in the user comments, people who still say, wow, I can't believe this.
Yeah. So we mostly did that during the primaries. To expand the question a little bit to like the response to our fact checking, it was about what you would expect. So you would certainly get some people writing in, criticizing, saying, how dare you say that about my candidate? That's to be expected. You'd also get thoughtful people writing in, quibbling with like the conclusion you came to and making an argument for why like maybe it was one notch off, which is totally fair. So it kind of varied, but we also had people write in and like say thank you in very nice terms for doing this, saying it's helpful in trying to get a grip on all the craziness in the campaign. So it kind of varied, but certainly there was a big demand among readers just in terms of people wanting to read this stuff. That we could definitely tell. Yeah.
So you have been talking about the service that you provide as a reporter to check the facts of what other people say. One of the things, though, that you also do as a reporter is decide which facts about Congress you're going to share with us. So could you just talk a little bit about what your day is like and how you make those decisions about where you're going to go to pursue the facts?
Sure.
And which ones you're going to share?
Yeah, and that's a, I think, an overlooked thing oftentimes, which is a lot of what it comes down to is choosing what the subject matter is, what you're going to focus on any given day. So for me right now, it depends a little bit. Some of that comes from talking to editors, talking to colleagues, trying to figure out what are the storylines we should be thinking about. For me, over the past few months, I had a fairly dedicated task, which was healthcare. So I was sort of thinking about what's the next step in this Obamacare repeal saga, and what questions should I be asking. And on Capitol Hill, a lot of things are kind of, a lot of where you go, what you do is based on the schedule. So a lot of my job is talking to members of Congress, and there are certain times where you could find them and talk to them, particularly when the Senate is voting and when the House is voting. So a lot of my day is based on, okay, the Senate has a vote at 2 o'clock, like that's when I need to go talk to folks, or the House has a vote at 5 o'clock, that's when I need to go talk to folks. But it's certainly a fair question, because there are many people proposing many different kinds of bills, and you know, a common thing would be like, well, why aren't you writing about X? And you're right, it comes down to trying to make choices based on, first of all, like what seems likely to progress and get serious consideration and maybe become law and will affect people. So you factor those sorts of things in. Yeah?
In terms of party affiliation, have you, in your experience in the New York Times or with any other news sources, seen any kind of differing treatment compared to what party one reporter or editor is affiliated with? Have you ever, with the media, especially on television, you'll see a great recurrence or a parallel in opinion between, for example, late night hosts. Have you seen any reporters that have been treated or published any differently depending on their party affiliation? Is that a problem in media today?
Not in my experience in terms of encountering people. I mean, I think different journalists handle this sort of thing in different ways. So, and I'm limiting what I'm saying now to like reporters who do news coverage, who don't do commentary, who don't do opinion columns, like sort of what I do. I'm sort of gonna limit myself to that area. Different people handle it in different ways. So we have ethical rules based on what kind of political involvement we can have, which understandably, if you cover politics, you can't partake. But even broader, beyond other folks in our newsroom, there are limits on what kind of political activity you can engage in, simply because it could give the appearance that our newsroom is picking sides or that sort of thing. The issue of party registration is one that different people handle in different ways. In my case, like I'm not registered with a party. There's a debate some people have about either, even if reporters should vote in like elections they cover. That's something people disagree about. So I don't think it really tends to factor in. I know every once in a while you'll see some story about, oh, this TV host donated money to this candidate or is registered with whatever. It's just a reminder, I think, to those of us who cover this stuff, to be very careful not to give the appearance of picking sides. And that's pretty much the rule that I go by kind of in anything in this realm is, just to bear in mind that, anything you do that can give the appearance of picking sides hurts our credibility and hurts us in terms of how our coverage is perceived. Yeah?
You mentioned the Pizzagate scandal and being a part of the Hillary campaign or contributing to it.
Yeah.
the involvement or the supposed involvement of John Podesta in the campaign, what is your take on that?
In what sense?
In the sense of accusations, is it considered something, would you consider that fake news? Would you consider that the accusations are outrageous?
I mean, my understanding of that whole thing is that it's entirely false and like a made up conspiracy. That I have not covered that particular. So this is just based off my reading coverage of it. I haven't written about it or reported on it, but that's my and I think. I mean, what that particular episode shows, I think, is that like things that fall in this basket of fake news can take on a lot of different forms. So it can be somebody sitting at home inventing a story because they want to make money from ad revenue on like their fake website. It can also be conspiracy-minded folks on the internet like reading into things. I'm not familiar enough with that to weigh in, but that's my understanding from coverage of it. Yeah.
Although many politicians criticize the media, none of them really say that news are fake or that they're the enemy of the American people. How do you think Trump's rhetoric about fake news will make mainstream media look for ways to gain the public's trust? And do you think they'll start to cover issues that are more significant to people and, like she was saying before, you know, start showing all of the facts, not just the facts that build on their perspective or their point of view?
Yeah, I mean, I think a couple things. I mean, for one, the general way I look at this, and this is not an original line by me, but others have said, and I think it's true, is that in response to, you know, criticism of our journalism or of journalism that's been done, like the best solution to that is to do more journalism and good journalism. So that's really what we can do. And I think that's what we are doing and others are doing. And it's understandable that politicians will criticize coverage that is unfavorable in their view. And you know, that's something we all have to live with. I do think there are a number of things that news organizations can do to help build trust and build engagement with readers and to improve our coverage, for sure. And it's being transparent about when we make mistakes and being clear when we correct things so people know that. I think there's a whole broader discussion about diversity in newsrooms. The idea being that if there's not a diversity in where people come from and their backgrounds and where in the country they were raised and that kind of thing, it can be easy to, you know, if you work out of a newsroom in Midtown Manhattan, that's a very different world than much of America. And we have people all over the country. I traveled all last year. But we can always do more to have newsrooms reflecting the diversity of the country. And that's something that I think translates into coverage that people can connect with and trust. So like that's another thing. But there are lots of things in this area that can be probably beyond what we're talking about. Yeah.
You mentioned diversity of the country, that it mirrors the diversity that's in the United States. Wouldn't you say that diversity of view would trump the diversity of the country?
Well, so yeah, the way I look at it is like I cover whatever candidates before me and maybe to me, like I'm not a particularly like politically opinionated person. I feel as if like you could put any candidate in front of me and I'll interview them and write about them. And to me, like it doesn't matter what party they're from, what left, right, whatever, like you cover the candidate you cover. I don't think, and I don't think you're like, when you're talking about putting a newsroom together, I don't think you're hiring people. If we're talking about like down the middle news coverage, not a publication with a perspective, you're not hiring people because of their like political outlook. You're covering them because they're fair journalists. I do think though, so like, one thing that's been talked about and written about with President Trump's success is obviously a significant portion of the country, you know, he spoke to them in a way that really resonated. And, you know, he did not do well in New York City. He did not, right? Like, it's a different, and there's certainly an argument. I think we did a pretty good job of getting out into the country and talking to people. We can always do a better job, and I think that was one takeaway, was the more we can do to, like, get a sense of how people across the political spectrum from lots of different lines of work, you name it, the better in terms of coverage. So that's how I look at it.
I know we have both students who have 5 o'clock classes, and there's one in this room as well, so that's all the questions we have time for today, but I'd like to thank you, Tom, so much.
Academic Video Services within the Division of Information Technology at Florida International University.